Katavkar sir and Dr. Pathan sir. I start this today's webinar. Sabhi ko namaskar. Good afternoon. It's my privilege to address the participants who had came from different states, different districts. Today is the fourth webinar of NEMA Legal Committee, and this is the 24th webinar from NEMA Web Series 1. Firstly, I pay my salutation to Lord Dhanvantari, and with this, just giving the introduction that from long time NEMA has been pioneer in promoting open medical science, or you can say integrated medical science. From last 1.5 months, NEMA had arranged almost 24 webinars about integrated approach in medical science. Our webinar on open science or integrated science today and tomorrow fits well into this contest, because integrated medical science is a good way to support the humanity, and my friend, it also realize our association vision to integrate medical science. I request our proctology society secretary Dr. Alok Gupta to please brief our motto regarding the webinar series. I request Dr. Alok Gupta to please brief the regarding the webinar series.
Thank you, Dr. Girish. Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
I'm excited that you all have here to participate in today's webinar. It's my privilege to welcome you all on behalf of NEMA Legal Cell, NEMA Proctology Society, NEMA Central. I welcome today's speaker, Dr. Dhananjay Kulkarni sir, and also I welcome today's expert panelist, Dr. Nitin Kotre sir, Dr. Rajendra Khatavkar sir, Dr. Pathan sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Welcome, sir.
Warm welcome.
Thank you, sir. I will use the next few minutes to tell you about the background of the webinar series and our motivation. Firstly, we want to present integrated approach in our practice and make them more visible for bigger public or delegate. Secondly, we want to discuss different medical legal aspects in broader context, and therefore we have invited legal experts from legal field. Integrated approach sounds fancy, but my friends, basically for we, it means the use of this integrated approach for further research and education, which will be beneficial for humankind. So our motto behind this, to call these experts to explore all these legal aspects at one platform. With these few words, I will request Dr. Deshmukh to please introduce our today's speaker, Dr. Dhananjay Kulkarni sir, and our expert, Dr. Nitin Kothare sir, Dr. Khatavkar sir, and Dr. Pathan sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Prashant Deshmukh. A pleasure to introduce renowned medical Dhananjay Kulkarni sir, and welcome to all NEMA members for this NEMA webinar. Dr. Dhananjay Kulkarni sir, welcome you. Sir did his BAMS from Vasanta. Also did LLB from Dayan College, and he is a scholar and university ranker holder, and he completed his LLM in human rights from Bharati Vidyapeeth Pune. He also completed postgraduate diploma in logistic and management from Symbiosis University. He is a practicing medical legal consultant since last 10 years, and then after he is a legal CC member, NEMA Legal Cell CC member. Sir is a renowned medical legal practitioner since last year. I welcome sir and I request sir to proceed for the further webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Prashant Deshmukh. With this introduction, I request Dr. Dhananjay Kulkarni, sir, to please continue with his lecture.
Yes, sir. Hello. Am I audible properly,
yes, sir?
Yes, sir. Visible properly?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, sir. So, friends and dignitaries, I would like to welcome you all in this webinar. And we have seen in this pandemic, the virus has not just entered human body to disturb us. But the virus has also entered in our life to devastate our lives. Our lives have changed a lot. Our profession has been changed. There are changes in our lifestyle. But the most prominent and most significant change has been come across in the laws with which we practice. Today we will try to figure it out what changes, what drastic changes there are in the law with respect to our practice. And we'll discuss all the specific laws which have been changed, and we will try to figure it out any problems which are incurred nowadays. I would like to have some disclaimer regarding this lecture before starting. This is just pure academic meeting. The views and thoughts expressed in this presentation are my personal one. References shown are regarding current legal status. The regulations are subject to change as per time and the law of lands areas. Please refer to current local guidelines orders for the fresh knowledge. Nothing is knowingly mentioned which is against government policy. We all are strongly supporting our government in this fight with pandemic, and there is nothing contrary to the policy of the government is mentioned. This disclaimer doesn't mean that it's धारावाहिक के सभी पात्र और घटनाएं काल्पनिक है और इसका वास्तविक जीवन से कोई संबंध नहीं है, ऐसा इसका मतलब नहीं है। इसका मतलब इतना ही है कि हम जो भी कह रहे हैं वो सिर्फ प्योरली नॉलेज और एकेडमिक्स के लिए कह रहे हैं, और व्हाटएवर हैज बीन टोल्ड ओवर हियर, व्हाटएवर हैज बीन रिकॉर्डेड ओवर हियर, इट्स जस्ट एकेडमिक पर्पस। सो लेट्स प्रोसीड। दिस इज व्हाट करंट क्राइसिस इज। देयर आर सम थिंग्स व्हिच आर ड्रैगिंग टुवर्ड्स आवर प्रैक्टिस, dragging us towards our practice, and there are certain things which are dragging away from our practice. What are those things? First is financial tension. Everybody has it. There are some financial obligations and for which we have to earn, and we have to go to practice in this crisis situation or pandemic situation. There is moral or ethical obligation that we have to treat, and we cannot run away from our practice in the difficult time like this. And there is moral or ethical obligation on us. There are certain government orders and notifications which are compelling us in a certain sense, which are compelling us or which are forcing us to practice, forcing us to work. And by these three things, we are forced or we are affirmatively attached to our practice. But there are certain things which are dragging away us from our practice. What are those things? Those are infection risk, the fear of infection risk. There is a family pressure. There are many comorbid patients in our family, and we care for them. So we try to cut away our practice or try to refrain from our practice. There are staff problems. Staffs are not coming to the hospitals or clinics, and that is why we are unable to practice properly. There are logistics issues. PPEs are not available, and N95 masks are not available. Even digital thermometers and infrared thermometers are not available in the remote areas. Patients are very non-cooperative. They are not wearing masks. They are not using social distancing. And that is why we are getting very much problems in our practice. And there are certain medico-legal issues or medico-legal problems, or we can say that lack of awareness due to which we are unable to practice or we are facing difficulties in the practice. But in these two situations, our common practitioner has been sandwiched, has been stressed, and that is why we are going to figure it out, or we are going to resolve it by discussion and by getting the knowledge regarding the legal issues. This is what current scenario is. every then and now new notifications and new regulations are coming, and this is creating such a mess in our mind that we are unable to know or unable to figure it out. And that is why there is a lot of confusion in our minds, that what to do and what not to do. This is current situation of our mind regarding the government notifications and regulations which are coming every now and then. We'll try to figure out most common and most serious question and most frequently asked question. And which is most fearful fact in our minds, will I be compelled to work? Or will there be any compulsion of duty regarding my practice? I would like to tell that there are certain regulations which are coming day by day, but we have to know that all those regulations which are coming are not only compelling us to practice, but they are giving a certain sense of duty towards us. We will take it in that way. First of all, we are having duties of three kinds. We are doing our private practice, we are working in certain private hospitals, or we are working in government hospitals. The problem of compulsion of duty or the issue of compulsion of duty is applied to all the three categories. Government can compel us to practice our own general practice or hospital practice. Government can acquire our hospitals or establishments, or government can acquire our service also, so as to work in establishments where government wants us to work. So there are two main laws which are in action now, that is Epidemic Diseases Act and Disaster Management Act. And if you will go through both the laws, there is no distinct order or there is no categoric mention about compulsion of duty about doctors. But these two laws or certain laws which are imposed now, which we'll discuss afterwards, authorities or executives have got very wide powers in this pandemic. The executives are sworn in with very much powers. By many ways, they can promulgate any order useful to contain the pandemic. And the gravity of that order or the penal action about that order, if not obeyed, that penal action promulgated depends on which act or section of that order is imposed. We will discuss the statutes by virtue of which the order can be promulgated henceforth. There are n number of orders which are coming now and then about regarding the compulsion of duties. And people are frightened that will I be able to practice or not, or will I be dragged into the government hospitals to do the compulsory duties. We'll consider first the Epidemic Control Act or Epidemic Diseases Act 1897, which was enacted in the plague epidemic in the year of 1897. The act is very short. It contains only four clauses, but the act is very powerful. The clause 2 or the section 2 of the act says that power to take special measures and prescribe regulation as to dangerous epidemic diseases. When any time state government is satisfied that the state or any part thereof is visited by or threatened with an outbreak of any dangerous epidemic disease, that is now the state government, the next section they will consider the central government too, if thinks that the ordinary provisions of the law for the time being in force are insufficient for the purpose, may take or require or empower any person to take such measures and by public notice prescribe such temporary regulations to be observed by the public or by any person or class of public. It shall deem necessary to prevent outbreak such disease, the spread thereof, and may determine in what matter, with what manner, and by whom expenses incurred. So this is what the action can be taken by the government, either state, center, or any designated authority regarding this pandemic. And by the virtue of this clause, they can compel us to practice, to compel us to duty. Disobedience, what if we disobey this, the order which has been promulgated under this act? Disobedience attracts the section 188 of IPC, section 188 of IPC. Wherever we disobey the order which has been promulgated by the officer under the Epidemic Control Act, we get the notice under section 188 of IPC. Section 188 is not that serious section of the IPC. So when the notice comes or show cause notice come from the government, you need not be frightened or need not be worried much. But you have to act accordingly, you have to take a legal support and give the answer to the authority regarding this notice. What section 188 says? Section 188 says, disobedience to order duly promulgated by public servant. Whoever, knowing that by an order promulgated by a public servant lawfully empowered to promulgate such order, he is directed to abstain from certain act or to take certain order, certain property with his position under the management, disobeys such direction, shall, in such disobedience, causes or tends to cause to obstruction, or which is most importantly, cause or tends to danger to human life, then it shall be punished with an imprisonment of either description of a term which may extend to 6 months or with fine which may extend to 1,000 rupees or with both. This is bailable offense. This is non-cognizable offense. And this offense is not that serious. But whenever there is an infringement of an order promulgated under the Epidemic Control Act, Section 188 IPC is attracted. We'll consider another act by which the order can be promulgated. This is Disaster Management Act 2005. According to the Section 26, power of chairperson of district authority. Here all the authority is our district magistrate. Under this act, all the authority comes, or the king of the district is the district magistrate or our collector. The collector or designated officer by him can promulgate an order for your compulsory duty. The chairperson of the district authority is definitely a collector, and collector or an officer which has been delegated by this power that can promulgate the order to compel you for practicing. So what if we infringe this order? The punishment for obstruction, etc., refuses to comply with any direction given by or on behalf of central government or by state government or national executive committee or state executive committee or district authority in this case under this act shall on conviction be punishable with imprisonment for a term which may extend to 1 year or fine or both, and if such obstruction or refusal comply with directions result in loss of lives or imminent danger thereof, this attracts our situation, shall on conviction be punishable with imprisonment for a term which may extend to 2 years. So this is a bit serious offense, a bit serious infringement of an order, and which may attract imprisonment up to 2 years. Still it is a bailable offense, still it is non-cognizable offense, and we can sort it out with the proper way. So these are two, what we say, the acts which are now imposed on us, and by virtue of which or by using it, a district magistrate or state authority can promulgate order to make you compelled to practice. But there is a certain laws in certain states which has been promulgated, like emergency acts. In Maharashtra also, there is a MESMA which has been imposed now, which has been provoked now. And this emergency act like MESMA is very stringent act, very, what we say, a strict act. And if the order has been promulgated or has been ordered under MESMA Act, there is a strong way that it has to be obeyed in every sense. Here, MESMA, in the definition section, it has been defined that any service connected with the maintenance of public health and sanitation, including hospitals and dispensaries. There is categoric mention of hospital and dispensary regarding MESMA Act. In prior two acts, we have not seen any categoric mention or specific mention about medical services. But in this act, like MESMA, there is very specific mention about hospitals and dispensaries. And if we are infringing the order regarding the MESMA, or which is coming under the MESMA, punishment we can see, notwithstanding anything contained in the Code of Criminal Procedure, the police officer may arrest without a warrant any person which is reasonably suspected of having committed any offense under this act. And second and most serious is, all offenses under this act shall be non-bailable. So this is most serious act which has been imposed in certain states like Maharashtra. And if the order has been promulgated under this act, there is no way out than to follow the order. And if the order has been infringed, then this can create a serious problems like arrest or like non-bailable arrests. So, which is the way out? What is the way out? If you are not able to do the duty as per the government guidelines or government orders, there is a way out that you can contact the government authority which has promulgated the order, and you can give in writing your answer, which is a legal one. If you are a comorbid person, if you are a lactating mother, if you have you are having any comorbid person which is dependent on you, if any of your spouse is doing the duty which is essential duty, and your children are helpless without you, then under certain conditions we can write down the officers which have promulgated this order, and if on their mercy or if they think that these reasons are fit, then they can allow us to get away from this order. This is the only way out. And regarding the ethical part, I think that we should all do our duties if at all we are having any minor problems. And if any serious problem is there, we have to contact the authority which has promulgated the order. And one day or another, the thing things are going to change. The situation is not properly, what we say, satisfactory regarding containing the disease. So one day or the another, we are all going to be compelled for the duties in government hospitals or etc. or certain hospitals. So we have to be ready for that. And if you are not ready, then we have to do the paperwork, and we have to give the legitimate answers to the so the authorities where the order has been promulgated. Then if this is so, then what is the use of Article 21 in the Indian Constitution? Article 21 in the Indian Constitution always has upper footings in every law. Regarding every law, Article 21, right to life, has upper footings. Then when we are risking our lives, then why should we obey an order which is risking our lives? This was the question asked in the court, and judiciary has given very prompt answer to it. And the case was filed in High Court of Andhra Pradesh, and writ petition was filed by Dr. Koila Gandla. And the answer given by court is very punctual. The court says that state government shall ensure to provide all necessary equipments like N95 masks, sterile medical gloves, starch aprons, personal protection equipments, and all other necessary things to all the doctors. If the state fails to do that, or the state is not able to protect doctor by giving all the logistics which are necessary to save his life, doctor has right to refuse his duty. But again, the question comes that like MESMA Act has been promulgated or has been imposed, then this section Article 21 may or may not be useful for us. But if in regarding any other situation, there is clear view given by the court that if government gives you all the logistics which are able to protect your life from the disease, then you have to do your duty. If the government is giving you the N95 mask, the necessary equipments like personal protection equipment, then you have no way out and you will have to do the duty. This is what all the view is regarding the duty. To summarize, I would like to say that there are three or four acts by which government can compel us to duty. And if not obeyed the order, there are certain punishments which we have discussed. And regarding the legal view or the view of the court, if the government is giving you all the logistics, then you have to do the duty. If you are not able to do the duty, you have to answer it in writing to the specific officer who has promulgated the order. And if he thinks fit, he will not compel you to duty. If necessary, I will give all the details in writing. And if necessary, you can contact me or any legal cell person on phone or on WhatsApp, and they will help you out in this regarding this problem. Then we'll move to next problem. Section 144 CRPC. Every day we see in the this is coming on my screen. Can I delete it?
No, sir. You can delete, or the person who have made that scratch, he can delete.
Okay.
I request that person to please delete that scratch.
This is very annoying, I think.
Yes, sir. Sir, you have one pen option there if you can find it.
Annotate.
Then from that pen option you can delete. Otherwise that person only can delete who has made it.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Every day in the newspapers or in any case, we see the section 144 has been Dhara 144 lagu ki gayi hai. So what is section 144 actually is? Section 144 belongs to section 144 of CRPC. What is CRPC? It is Criminal Procedure Code. Criminal Procedure Code is different from Indian Penal Code. Indian Penal Code is substantial law and Criminal Procedure Code is procedural law. And this procedural law gives you gives immense power, gives certain power, prohibitory action or nishedh adnya, pratibandhatmak adesh. This power has been given to executive officers like district magistrate or subdivisional magistrate, and they can promulgate the order under section 144. Section 144 doesn't mean curfew. Many of people are having in their mind that section 144 means curfew. Curfew is not section 144. It is just a prohibitory order. As for example, I will say there was a prohibitory order given by I think Indore DM regarding Chinese manja, patang ka manja, or in certain districts the 144 were imposed regarding POP Ganesh murtis in Rajasthan, I think. So DM can give any order which is prohibited, which can prohibit people from doing anything or refrain people from doing anything. And the section 144 doesn't mean that curfew or shoot at sight or something like that. We'll discuss it. In cases where the opinion of a district magistrate, subdivisional magistrate or any other executive magistrate, specially empowered by the state government in his behalf, there is sufficient ground for proceedings under this section and immediate prevention of speedy remedy is desirable. Such magistrate may, by written order stating the material facts of the case and served in a manner provided in section 134, direct a person to abstain from a certain act to get certain order or respect to the certain property in possession under the management, if such magistrate considers that such direction is likely to prevent or tend to prevent such obstruction, annoyance or injury to any person lawfully employed, a danger to human life, health and safety, which has been imposed now for this reason. Section 144 has been imposed for this reason because there is a danger to human life, health and safety. So if we infringe section 144 order, what will happen? Only section 188 of IPC will be attracted, which we have discussed earlier, which is non-cognizable and a bailable offense. So this is section 144 CRPC. I think this discussion is limited to legal matter. So just for a general information, I discussed section 144 CRPC and we'll move to the next slide. So this is a very common question which is oftenly asked. Can I refuse to treat the COVID patient? The answer is yes. But if the local authority or the state government has promulgated any order regarding compelling you to treat a COVID patient, you cannot refuse a patient because this is subject to the orders of the local authority. So the primary answer is yes, but subject to the orders of local authority. If your center is non-COVID hospital, you can refuse treatment to COVID patient and direct the patient to COVID dedicated hospital. But in the case of emergency, you have to attend the patient and give primary treatment with proper precautions before referring. This is very important. This right of a doctor to refuse a patient never applies in emergencies because we have Clinical Establishment Act, and in Clinical Establishment, it is clearly said that no patient can be referred without in emergency. No patient can be referred without treating or without giving primary aid. Even in Parmanand Katara case, Parmanand Katara versus Union of India case, Supreme Court has also given the guidelines that no patient shall be referred directly without giving any first aid or primary healthcare treatment. So, the answer to the question is you can refuse to treat a patient which is COVID positive or which is suspected as a COVID, strongly suspected as a COVID positive. But you have to do primary treatment in the case of emergencies. Otherwise, you are free to refer the patient or free to direct the patient to the COVID dedicated hospital or government hospitals. We'll move to next slide. This is most devastating and brainstorming question, which has been asked many a times in many webinars, and a lot of stuff is going on this question, that consent is necessary in this. Is consent necessary in COVID-19 pandemic? Is consent necessary? The primary answer is no. Why? See, we give consent, or we get a consent from the patient. Generally, a generalized consent is taken, implied consent is everywhere, but express consent or informed consent is given by the patient in the case of surgeries only. And we are really under pandemic. The Epidemic Act has been imposed. So there is a general risk or generalized risk regarding the disease, and which is well known to everybody. There is no need to give knowledge to the patient about the disease, or there is no need to give any specific direction to the patient that about the disease, because it is generalized risk. There is a presumption of common knowledge of the disease spread. For example, I will give you, if you are going in a taxi, and if you will go inside a taxi, a taxi driver say to you this, "Dekh baba, tu to baitha hai mere taxi mein, lekin accident bhi ho sakta hai, you may get injured or you may even die." Aisa koi consent likh kar deta hai kya taxi wala? In that sense, there is a generalized risk of accident, and in this sense also, there is generalized risk of COVID-19 infection in any hospital. There is presumption of generalized risk, so there is no need of any consent. There is no legal custom of getting consent regarding specific diseases. If we see, if the patient is getting admitted in our hospital and is going to stay for a long, then there are many possibilities that the patient can be infected with many diseases. There can be a dengue, there can be malaria, there can be any nosocomial infection which can infect the patient. Do we take any category consent of every disease in every indoor patient? No. There is no legal custom of getting consent regarding any specific disease. So regarding COVID also, there is no need to take any specific consent. And if patient is alleges that he or she got infected in your clinic or hospital, will it stand in court of law? No. There is no stand of that allegation in the legal scrutiny, because patient will find it difficult to prove that he or she got infected only at your clinic or hospital. We'll see that patients are moving everywhere. Disease is everywhere. Patient comes to you in your OPD or in your surgical hospital, or patient gets delivered, or in anything procedure is done on the patient. And patient, before coming to you or after coming to you, if goes and wanders everywhere and gets infected, there is no proof that patient has only got infection in your hospital only. So patient cannot prove that the infection was happened only at your clinic or hospital. Patient aapke paas aa sakta hai aur dusre din jaake liquor shop ke line mein khada reh sakta hai, theek hai na? To aise halat mein to usko infection kahan ho gaya, ye hum designate nahi kar sakte hain. So there is no ground for any defense that patient have got infection only at the clinic or hospital. And courts are usually lenient in this such medical emergencies. If even if anybody sues you, courts are very lenient. Up till now, there is no case happened under section 269 or 270 in that particular hospital has spread infection due to reckless use of staff or recklessness of any doctor. So courts are up till now very lenient about medical emergencies like COVID-19. And most important thing is Section 4 of the Epidemic Diseases Act says that protection to persons acting under this act. We are under Epidemic Diseases Act now, and we are acting under this act now. So we are being protected by the court that no suit or any other legal proceedings shall lie against any person for anything done in good faith intended to be done under this act. So court has barred us from any suit regarding these issues. But I would like to say that this is not a blanket immunity given by court for any suit. If there is any serious negligence or any serious act done by the doctor or a staff, court can take cognizance of such cases, and this Section 4 will not apply over there. Otherwise, you will say that anything will happen and nobody can sue me in this Epidemic Diseases Act. This is not a case. This is just for a titular offenses or certain minor offenses or minor allegations which are there. And this will not stand, or this will not give you a blanket immunity regarding serious offenses or serious medical negligences, gross negligences. So regarding these three points, we can say that patient sues us in the court regarding the infection, the court will not do anything, or court will help us in this regarding this particular point. Still, if some people want more safety, or they want to be more safer, we shall keep a receipt of purchase of PPEs which have purchased. That we have purchased PPEs and we are using PPEs, we are not spreading the disease, we are using proper logistics, and we can display the photos or posters regarding hygiene and distancing which we are taking in our place. We can display those in our hospitals, that this is happening in our hospital or in a clinic. And we can have a declaration from the patient as per specimen given. You can take a screenshot of that declaration, or I can share the link in the description box regarding this declaration. This is the declaration where we are saying that we are suggesting the patient that what he must do in our hospital and what he must not do in the hospital, and we are giving all the onus, all the burden on the patient, that if you are not, you will not follow these instructions, then you are able to get infected and we will not be responsible for your infection. This is two-page consent. And if you want to be more safer, or there is any serious surgical operative, or there is any longer stay for the patient, then you can get this consent in the from the patient. But otherwise, in the regular procedures, in the regular OPDs or regular admissions, consent categorically regarding COVID-19 is not necessary at all. We'll move to the next slide. Can I issue certificate of fitness for travel? Yes. We have right to certify regarding every certification. But RMPs can certify, registered medical practitioner can certify, but subject to the regulations issued by the authorities. Because in certain states or certain areas, only government officials or government officers are only given authority to give certificate regarding fitness of travel. So you have to get proper knowledge of the whatever order has been given. And if not so, you can definitely give that certificate for travel. But if you are satisfied that after proper clinical examination and screening, and if the patient is really not suffering from any flu-like symptom, then only you have to give the certificate. Otherwise, if please refuse to certify if you are not sure about the absence of flu-like illness, if you have tested or you have examined him from the further distance and you are not able to come to conclusion that patient is not suffering definitely from flu-like illness, or patient is unable to give proper history, or patient is lying about his history and you are doubtful about the history, please refuse to certify him. For certain amount or certain titulary amount, please don't give such certificate, because if the patient gets, if the patient is already positive here, or patient has been home quarantined, you are not able to know that. And if the patient goes to the another state and spreads the disease, very serious sections can be attracted regarding this certification. But here are some states like Maharashtra are allowing to travel on self-declaration of person, that I'm not suffering from certain and certain disease and I'm able to travel. If this is so, there is no case arises, no reason arises to give any certificate for fitness, and there is no need to give you certificate. The certificate which has been printed or format which has been printed, you have to write down at the foot, you have to write down a footnote under the certificate. Does this information given in the certificate is as per data collected from the patient, and this only one sentence is sufficient, that the data given in the certificate is as per information given by the patient or relative. We are not able to verify it, and we are not able to rectify it also. So finally, we can give the certificate, but only after, if you are sure about the position of the patient and the history of the patient, then and then only give the certificate. Though new law has been promulgated, or new law has been enacted by the central government regarding assault on doctors. We were in demand of such a stringent law against assault on doctors from long time. But as the pandemic came, the government started loving us a lot, and hence government has enacted such a law, very stringent law regarding assault on doctors. This has been promulgated, this has been enacted as a amendment in the Epidemic Diseases Act, and this is not a separate law, this is just a amendment given in the Epidemic Diseases Act, and we will see what that act is and how stringent it is and how it is useful in our regular practice. The section 1A first says that that defines the violence, what violence is. The act of violence includes harassment or intimidation impacting living or working conditions. This is very important decision. Not only bodily injury, but the harassment, any kind of harassment or intimidation, which is also coming in this purview of, within purview of this act. And this is a very, very important thing. Section 3 says that punishment for the act is from 3 years to 7 years, fine from 50,000 to 5 lakh rupees. That makes the law very, what we say, deterrent and very strict. And whoever does this act will be will have the deterrent mind over this act. And people who are doing this such a evil work will think twice before doing it. Section 3 says that offense is cognizable and non-punishable. The offenses which are done in regarding this act are definitely cognizable, dakhal patra, and non-bailable. Bail nahi mil sakta is bare mein. So it makes it more stronger. Investigations by a police officer not below the rank of inspector. Inspector, not below the rank of inspector means the investigation is done by very higher authority and which has got very much powers regarding the investigation since criminal procedure code. So this is very important thing. Investigation to be completed within 30 days of filing an FIR. The capping of limiting the investigation is very important. Otherwise, the investigation goes and goes on and goes on, and doctor cannot do anything, and doctor can't do every day to police station refraining from his practice, and investigation keeps on going. There is a capping of investigation that has to be completed within 30 days of filing an FIR. Trial to be conducted expeditiously and to be concluded within 18 months. This is also an important thing. Trial 18 months mein kisi bhi halat mein khatam honi chahiye. Zyada lambi nahi honi chahiye. Iska bhi khayal isme rakha gaya hai. Most important is presumption that the offense has been committed unless the contrary to be proven. There is a generalized principle in the penal code that the offense has to be proven by the state or by the state party or the government. And there is a generalized presumption of innocence on the accused. This is general principle. But there is a presumption of, in this act, the thing is in the contrast. The presumption of offense has been committed. So who has committed the offense, there is presumption that he is committed that offense. And onus of proof or burden of proof to disprove this is on the person who has committed this offense. This is very important thing. Culpable mental state of accused is to be presumed. This is very, very particular thing. If the person, any accused of certain this act, if says that I was unknowingly doing that and there was no intention of mine to do that, this will not be a safeguard for him. And culpable mental state is be presumed. Compensation payable will be twice the amount of fair market value of damaged property. If anybody damages the property, the compensation payable will be twice the amount of fair market value. And compensation, most important thing is regarding compensation. Compensation can be recovered as arrears on land revenue. If you are you have got any compensation from the court, you have to do certain decree or you have to do another suit for recovery of that amount. But in this case, you can just go to the tahsildar and attach the property of the person and get that revenue, get that amount of compensation from the revenue, land revenue. This is very easy procedure, and this is very easiest procedure we can say, and this is what the most beautiful thing which has been enacted in this act. This is one of the strongest penal law in India, and we must congratulate the government, appreciate the government, and thank the government that they have listened to us, which demand was coming from very long years, and government has really, we have to really appreciate the government that they have done such a toughest penal law. It is one of the very toughest penal law regarding light atrocity or various laws which are there in India. There, this is one of the very toughest law, penal law in India. But you will say that my presentation is full of buts. But where there is law, there is but, there is however, there is if, and there are provisos. So but is inevitable in legal lectures. This is an amendment to Epidemic Diseases Act, and this will be withdrawn when the act will be revoked. When the pandemic will be over, the act of Epidemic Diseases Act will be revoked, and as a result, the act which has been imposed now will also be withdrawn, and action of the effect of this toughest penal law regarding assault on doctors will also be revoked. It will remain in force only during this pandemic, and it is temporary in nature. When the pandemic will be over, the effect of this law will also be over. And if as it is an ordinance, it is not an enacted law in parliament, which has been passed by Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, and signed by the governor, signed by the president of India. This is just an ordinance. So it has only life of 6 months. This has to be gets expired in after 6 months. This has to be again promulgated. Again, ordinance has to be renovated, and then only the ordinance will have its life. So regardless of these negative points, I think that government will not forget us after this pandemic, and they will continue this act. And I think this should not be the case that government will forget us, and this scene will continue, and we don't expect this scene after pandemic is over from government. We'll move to the next slide. Life insurance cover given by the government. We personally congratulate government and appreciate that they have covered the private practitioners also under this insurance cover of Garib Kalyan Yojana. And documentarily, I would say, they have covered us in this Garib Kalyan Yojana, and 50 lakh insurance has been given to us. But there is again a but, and this is very difficult or impossible to execute, as private healthcare institution has been provided this insurance, but certificate of employment by the director, medical superintendent, or head of the institution is necessary. So if I'm owning a hospital and I run my own hospital, who is going to give me the certificate of employment? The director, medical superintendent, or head of institute, nobody is going to give me. If any person comes to me and I get infected, then government will need this certificate of employment, which I will not be having. So I will not be able to get benefit of this insurance. Second thing, they have to certify and submit proof of the deceased was deployed or drafted for care and may have come in direct contact with the COVID-19 patient. This we cannot do. We cannot certify or we cannot get certification that we have been deployed to care the COVID patient, and we have been deployed and we have been come across the direct contact of COVID-19 patient. This is also not possible. So general private practitioners which are coming in contact of COVID patient and getting infected, they are not categorically, practically not covered in this insurance cover. Documentarily, private healthcare institution is covered, but practically it is not possible to get that cover. So I urge everybody to get your own death benefit schemes. And the important thing is for anybody, this never covers any illness criteria or any expenses for the illness. This is only death benefit, and which cannot be enjoyed by you anytime. So I urge everybody to have some medical insurance and have some death insurance also. Because we are doing our hardest job in our profession, and this is the hardest time of our profession, and we have to be insured properly. So even if government is saying that we have covered private healthcare institutions, unfortunately I would say that practically we are not covered by the insurance cover given by the government, and we have to get our own bread for us, and we cannot depend on government regarding the insurance. False claims regarding Ayush medicines. See, every then and now we are seeing that on WhatsApp, on YouTube, so many people are coming who are even not doctors or registered doctors also. And they are coming with COVID remedies, Ayush COVID remedies. One is doing giving Pudina, one is going Trikatu, and n number of things are arsenic album, and n number of things are marketed in the market on social media platforms. And if anybody does that, we have this sort of order by the government, and we'll definitely as an organization, as an association, and on personal level also, we can stop this, and we will have to look at the sections that false claims and publicizing so-called approval research study or product manufactured about COVID-19 control from Ministry of Ayush, writing COVID or COVID-19 related claims and name of Ministry of Ayush on the labels of containers of Ayush products. Any other false claim or statement about Ministry of Ayush on COVID-19 is punishable. And there are certain enactments by which this is punishable. We can read or we can have a photocopy of that. And if any person does so, please refrain that person from doing so, because he is not harming the people, but also our science of Ayurveda and Ayush sciences are also being harmed by the false claims which are done by the people. So we all personally must also be refrain from doing such an act, and also we must refrain other people from doing such acts. So the negligence in pandemic. The criteria of negligence in pandemic is the same. If you will see, we have discussed the criteria of negligence in our last lecture. Standard of care is must. Even if you are doing the practice with distancing, even if you are doing telemedicine, even if you are doing any phone calls or practice by any other means, standard of care remains the same. The reasonable or the proper standard of care must be maintained. Otherwise, case of negligence can be sued upon you. Doctrine of unforeseeability is alive regarding the doctors. We cannot ascertain, we cannot see the patient is, whether patient is having COVID-19 or not. If a patient comes to you and if he turns positive after a certain time, then the doctrine of unforeseeability applies. And, you can get the elaborated explanation about this unforeseeability in my last lecture. And doctrine of unforeseeability applies here. And if you are having, you have seen the COVID patient, and again, if after a certain time he comes positive, you are not responsible for that. Contributory negligence, if the history given by the patient is half, or history given by the patient is not proper, and if you are not able to diagnose COVID patient, then there will be a contributory negligence on your part and the patient part. So the contributory negligence will also apply in this situation. Vicarious liability, if any staff of your does anything ill or anything improper thing that will end up in injury to the patient, then you are vicariously liable for the act of the staff. Or if you are acting in any hospital, and if you have acted in a negligent manner and which harms the patient, then your hospital or your superiors will be liable for your act. Last one is documentation, which has been the utmost important thing in every kind of situation, and it is utmost required in this situation also. You have to properly document your every patient, and you have to do the certain proper documentation regarding suspected patients also, comorbid patients also. In our Solapur branch, Nima Solapur branch, we have done Google forms, and every day our practitioners fill those Google forms and send it to the MOs or district health authorities. So the district health authorities are getting the proper documentation of the patients, of the suspects, of the comorbid patients. And this is very useful. So documentation has nevertheless, every time it is important, and it was important and it is important. The last, not the least topic is telemedicine. We will have to give another lecture for telemedicine, separate lecture for telemedicine. But I have covered all the telemedicine parts in short, and I will read those out. All RMPs are eligible. All the registered medical practitioners are eligible to practice telemedicine. Don't go in Niti Aayog guidelines. They have only mentioned there 56 Act RMPs are eligible. don't go there. IOS department has given another guidelines, and go to those guidelines. We are all eligible for telemedicine. Applicable to all platforms, in video, audio, WhatsApp, text, emails, but prefer video consultation always. Exclude surgical or invasive procedures by default. It is not temporary way of practice. This is very important. Government is going to come with 3 months or 1 month programmed course for telemedicine, and telemedicine is going to be there forever. It is not temporary, or it is not only for the pandemic situation. Telemedicine will be forever. Government in shortly will come with a course of 1 month, and if after doing that course, you will be able to practice telemedicine forever. There are some apps are also coming. There are some companies which are coming, which are giving us end-to-end transcription and proper logistic for telemedicine, and it will be forever. Identification of patient and RMP is utmost required. Identification of yours and patients is utmost required. Consent implied or express is necessary. Implied consent is when the patient calls you. There is implied consent that patient is calling you. But if you have called the patient, or you have initiated the discussion, or you have initiated the consultation, the express consent of the patient is necessary. Diagnosis with due application of mind is mandatory. If you are not having assurance that the diagnosis is correct, you can stop the teleconsultation and you can ask the patient to come across you in a live consultation. So diagnosis is utmost required. Proper diagnosis is utmost required. Or in diagnosis due to telemedication is utter negligence. Prescription must be in standard format and should not contain prohibited drugs. There are certain lists of drugs given in the telemedicine guidelines, that there are list O, list X, and etc. There you should not prescribe which are prohibited. Generally, which are in schedule X drugs, which should not prescribe, or drugs which are having vishas in Ayurveda practice, you should not prescribe in telemedicine. Confidentiality must be maintained, no doubt. Confidentiality is a must criteria, and you should not publish the telemedicine consultations or videos or photographs of the patient without getting consent from the patient. Record maintenance is must. Your call logs, your emails, your WhatsApp chats, or whatever, the record maintenance is must. Prescription copies, record maintenance is must. And of course, you can charge for the telemedicine, but receipt must be given to the patient. If you are getting a fees, you must give the receipt to the patient. This is all telemedicine is in, I have discussed in nutshell, and we can have any telemedicine lecture in future so that we can elaborate all the points. I would like to thank all for patient listening, and I would like to thank Nima Proctology Society, Dr. Dhadve sir, Dr. Daga sir, and everybody who participated in this lecture. And thank you so much for all the viewers who listened very carefully and patiently. Thanks a lot.
So friends, this is our legal committee. You may have been realized that how hard our NEMA's legal committee is working and doing studies and taking each and every effort to clear your all legal related aspects. I thank Dr. Dhananjay Kulkarni sir for giving thorough presentation regarding this in need topic. In this epidemic, all we are so confused regarding legal aspects of the practice. I will say almost all doubts you have cleared. Not only you have presented our rights, but also you have given our duties, what we should do in this epidemic. With this, I request our panelists, Dr. Nitin Kothare sir, Dr. Pathan sir, and Dr. Khatavkar sir, to please enlighten the subject. Dr. Nitin Kothare sir.
Congratulations, Dr. Dhananjay.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot, sir.
Very, very nice lecture. A very good compilation of relevant topic, relevant act, the sections and everything.
Thank you,
hope
sir. Thank
you. All must got it.
Bye.
Shall we proceed for question answer?
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Yep.
I will sum up at the last. Dr. Pathan, you want to talk something? Dr. Pathan,
no, sir? No, sir. Very elaborate.
Yeah, yeah. It was very nice. Very nice. And it was really an update for even a medical legal consultant like us also. You have elaborated some new things also added to our dictionary, that some Andhra's case. It was definitely new for us. And even limitation of all the cases, section 144 and all the things you have elaborated in very nice way, in a comprehensive manner. And let us see what our attendee doctors have, the various queries. There is one Vikas Khebade. He is asking, in our Kher Taluka, Tahsildar and Taluka Health Officers put our duties in COVID care center, can be denied, and what legal action can be taken and against our MCM members? I think this question is well answered by today's speaker. If at all some new thing you want to ask, is there Dr. Vikas? Vikas Khebade is there? Hello? I think this answer is well answered in his speech. All the aspects. Dhananjay, you want to ask?
Yes, sir. Hello?
Yes?
Yes, sir, audible.
I think he has answered all my queries very nice way. Thank you very much.
Okay, okay. We'll proceed for next one. Next thing. Sir, Dr. Arvind Tiwari is asking, sir, consent, COVID consent to be taken before doing any anorectal procedure like Charsutra application, etc.
Consent is not mandatory. If you are very cautious about it, or if you want to be more, what we say, safe, we can get a consent. I have given the consent form format over here, and you can get that.
And he told the another thing, the implied consent and all those things. Let us move to another question. Raghunath, Dr. Raghunath is asking.
Did he ask for COVID consent or generalized consent?
He is asking COVID consent. COVID consent.
COVID consent is not necessary at all.
Yeah. It is understood that if somebody is coming to you, that he has got implied consent is there, and you need not take expressed consent for COVID. So you have well answered that during your speech, sir. Dr. Raghunath is asking, our Ayush doctor fighting in front line in government hospital, but IMA is running away. Is there any law or guidance to defend them? I think this is again deviation from the topic. But okay, we can't avoid in brief. Or Dr. Kothay will take care of this question. Dr. Kothay?
Please repeat question, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Ayush doctors are fighting in front line in government hospital. But IMA is running away. Is there any law or guideline to defend them?
This is not a legal question. This is a strategic question. Yeah. And if my, what we say, mentor Dr. Tembunikar sir is here, he will definitely take care of it in the near future.
For the next question.
So, questions who cause debate and this thing, we will take at the end.
Yes, yes.
Much more questions are, and there is no law such that which can compel doctor of one petty and all those things. So, in short, I am given answer. Let us see what next. I'm just covering the latest that every question should be answered. No question should be get unanswered. Everybody is
Can I read?
Yes, please.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah. Please.
Is it mandatory to do COVID swab test of the of patient before proctology surgeries? From Dr. Praveen Patil, Malchiras.
Okay. COVID swab test, he's asking. Okay.
Is it to do COVID swab test of the patient before proctology surgeries?
For any surgery. See, there are two ways for this answer. One is legal way, another is practical way.
Practical way.
And legal way is that if you are having a patient indoor and if you are going to do a swab test, legally it is not necessary. It is not mandatory to get a swab test of each and every patient. There is difference in screening and testing. If you screen the patient properly, if he's having no signs and symptoms of the flu-like illness, and if he is not being in contact with anybody who is coming from outside India or in the red zone, or anybody of his kin are having any infectious disease, if you screen them properly, then there is very seldom need of doing test. Screening is important. Test is not that important.
Yes.
These are the written guidelines from the AYUSH department.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Here I wanted to add one thing. Yes.
Elective surgery is not test.
Primary screening, the physician or surgeon, whoever, if he will decide whether it is necessary or not. But as seeing the current scenario, the cases are day by day increasing. It is still now, currently the cases are around 2 lakhs in country. It is expected by July end, the cases in the COVID positive cases in the country will be around 30 lakhs in July end, till July. If this prediction goes wrong, let us say 50%. So it will be 7 times the number, today's existing number. So the answer of this question in the increasing number will vary. So because I remember the days in the 90s when in our area malaria was so rampant that even for a headache we used to give chloroquine to cover the atypical presentation. So that day will come to cover the atypical presentation. So it will vary.
See, the doctor, respected doctor, asking question from that area where private testing is not available. So it is practical answer to him is better not to do the testing inevitably to every patient. It's from Karmal, I think.
Sir, may I add?
Rajesh Shabra. No, yes, he's
please,
from
sir.
Malchiras. He's from
Kothres, Malchiras. Kothres.
May I add something?
Yes, sir. Yes. Please, sir.
As far as my personal opinion is concerned, it is going to be one of the mandatory norm in future.
Yeah.
As like BTCT, sugar, HIV, and the corona will be the test will be there. One thing.
Before surgery.
Pre-operative protocol.
It's come under the pre-operative protocol.
Second thing, you cannot put the life in danger of your supporting staff, including anesthetist.
Yes, sir. Yes.
So, from my side, it is advisable to put that test on your pathological test sheet. Mm-hmm. Third thing is, though this test is not present in some area or in some district also, but in coming 1 or 1.5 months, this test will be available everywhere.
Okay.
Because Indian made kit is going to be made provided there by the government, and the private lab owner will be making that available with their center.
Yeah, rapid test.
And last but not least, at least mention this test as an advice.
Okay.
Mention that test. It may done or may not be done, but you will be protected from any legal.
That you have performed your legal duty.
Sir, but if we have advised and patient has not done, so how you have proceeded for the surgery then? It can be a question. Right? If CTPT right, and I have right, advised sir. And we have not done, why you have taken that patient to proceed with it?
In that case, you can have a point to refuse the patient.
We will go through the guidelines first, and if the guidelines will change, we will act accordingly. Right now, the guidelines are saying that test is not mandatory for elective surgeries.
Yes, government has not given a protocol.
Protocol. If the protocol will come, guidelines will come, no, tests are available, and everybody will do that. No problem at all.
But practically, if you are doing operation of more than the surgery or anything procedure for more than 30 minutes,
yes.
Then practically, we have to do the COVID test before admitting.
Yes.
After admitting the patient.
Correct, sir.
Yes.
Another question from Dr. Rajesh Chhabra. Advice to get investigations for COVID-19 test is being declined by private labs, citing reason that ICMR guidelines specify that only MBBS can write this investigation. Sir, is it so? Any Delhi. Such guy,
he's from Delhi,
guidelines
Dr. Chhabra?
Have, from Delhi.
Yes, sir.
Any such sir question complete only though. In such any such guidelines you have come across, Dr. Rajesh Chhabra from Delhi.
Sir, the guidelines are there, and they do not categorically say that Ayush practitioners cannot prescribe, but they have given in the eligibility clause RMP. And definition of RMP according to central government or central authorities is according to 56
Act.
And 1956 Act says that only MBBS are RMPs, and we are all not coming under purview of that RMP definition. So the problem arises over there. Now the present scenario is that 56 Act has been revoked, and the governing body of the NMC bill has been coming action. So there is no question of 56 Act, and we have to go to the authority and write down to them that this is obsolete Act of 56 now, and you have to go to that authority and write down to them if they are declining your requirement of test.
Nitin Dada.
It is not logical now.
Sir, in a reverse way, can a doctor compel a patient to undergo investigation? Let me complete. जो क्वेश्चन पूछा है ना उसके अपोजिट कैन ए डॉक्टर कंपेल ए पेशेंट टू अंडरगो इन्वेस्टिगेशन फॉर कोविड एंड इफ द पेशेंट रिफ्यूजेस देन व्हाट शुड ए डॉक्टर डू टू बी लीगली करेक्ट यानी अपोजिट ऑफ दैट क्वेश्चन यानी कैन ए डॉक्टर कंपेल ए पेशेंट टू अंडरगो इन्वेस्टिगेशन फॉर या हां इफ ए पेशेंट रिफ्यूजेस देन व्हाट शुड ए डॉक्टर डू टू बी लीगली करेक्ट
He will refuse the patient.
Case,
he has every right to refuse the patient.
Patient can directly refuse. What doctor has to be doing that? If a patient, I will say, if a patient falls within the category of a COVID suspects as laid down in the government advisory, a doctor can only advise a patient to undergo investigation. He cannot give in writing that you do this. He should consult the patient or attendants to go for investigation. If the suspect, that is patient or his attendants, indicate that they will not perform the investigation advice, shall we notify the authority? Or shall we record in our record book or in our OPD book or in a prescription that the patient is not doing? What is correct? The fact that patient is suspect and your assessment as the investigation advice by him should be done. What should a doctor do in this, sir? This is question for us only.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Let us go. What Dhananjay wants to say first.
See, if we are suspecting a patient, we should not refrain from testing the patient. If government allows us to prescribe a test, on of our own, we will do the test. If government doesn't allow us to do the test, we have to refer the patient to the authority where it can be tested.
Yes.
So it is not only right of us, but duty of us, legal duty of us, to refer a suspect and get it tested.
And many doctors have been they have got the notice who has prescribed for COVID.
This is wrong thing. This should not happen.
That Jilani's notice, no, about you.
Dr. Chetan Vilani, a senior consultant of
government. It has been withdrawn, sir.
That was withdrawn that the...
But after protest from AMC.
Yes. What the IMA says that IMA is in the body to cancel the registration or cancel the registration of a doctor, not that governing body. In that way, it has been withdrawn. It's Dr. Chetan Vilani, I think, sir.
Yeah, Ghatkopar doctor.
He was a senior consultant of Ghatkopar. Received a notice from BMC. And he was a doctor who managing the COVID ICU in Kohinoor Hospital, Kurla West. And show cause notice has been given to him. I think he has prescribed over phone, I think.
Yeah, 19 patients he had advised.
I think Dr. Chhabra sir's answer is yet to complete. I would like to ask Dr. Kohale sir that you would like to add something on it. Kohale sir.
Hello.
Nitin sir.
Nitin dada.
Till that time we will continue with next question.
Dharga just a sir, minute. I would like to add, if he is not there, Dhananjay has said that we can, if the RMP according to 56 Act, that is IMC 56 to be precise, that is also invoked and now it is under the cancelled. At the same time, our Act, IMC 70 is also repealed. But on some prescribed format, it is clear-cut written. Many of my students are also complaining that those lab technicians who come to accept the samples after seeing the degree of doctor, they are not accepting. This is the cry of our ISM doctors throughout the country.
We have to act accordingly then. We have to write to that lab. We'll have to write to the authorities. And we have to act accordingly. We'll go into that, sir.
Okay.
Nitin, sir.
Rajesh Chhabra.
Perhaps he is not there. Take next question.
No, sir is there. Sir.
Temudikar, sir, want to add something to that?
No, not really.
Kothale, sir is there.
The question is regarding RMP.
Yes, sir. 56 Act.
Whether it is specifically mentioned that 56 Act of RMP?
No, somewhere it is MBBS.
But whether if there is a express provision saying that RMP from 56, then there will be the limitation for 56. Otherwise not.
If they have expressly written MBBS, then no other option.
If it is
then
written,
we have to send to government hospital where the...
Definitely. If express provision is not there, then you can make the complaint regarding the refusal.
Okay.
Great.
ICMR issues for that. ICMR issues guidelines about that. Dr. Rajesh Chhabra says.
56 RMP is written or not?
Better to open mic of, mute on to Dr. Rajesh Chhabra. Rajesh Chhabra from Delhi.
Dr. Rajesh Chhabra, please unmute here.
Good evening, sir. I'm from Delhi, Rajesh Chhabra.
Nima Delhi.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir. Good evening.
Good evening, Dr. Ajanda, Dr. Nitin, sir, Dr. Dhananjay, sir.
Yes, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, matter has been discussed. बट यहाँ पे बड़ा क्लियर कट ये कहते हैं कि आईसीएमआर की जो गाइडलाइंस है दैट क्लियरली स्पेसिफाई दैट ओनली ऑन द प्रिस्क्रिप्शन ऑफ ए एमबीबीएस डॉक्टर वी विल गेट द कोविड 19 टेस्ट डन नॉट ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ द प्रिस्क्रिप्शन ऑफ अ बीएमएस डॉक्टर सो आई फील द मैटर शुड बी टेकन एट द लेवल ऑफ आईसीएमआर नॉट एनी एट एनी अदर लेवल और सर जैसे अभी डॉक्टर नितिन सर ने बोला था कि इन द कमिंग डेज दिस टेस्ट इज गोइंग टू बी मैंडेटरी कि हम कोई भी प्री ऑप इन्वेस्टिगेशन कराते हैं तो उसमें कोरोना का टेस्ट हमें कराना पड़ेगा तो अगर हमारे प्रिस्क्रिप्शंस बाउंस होंगे तो शारसूत्र सर्जरी से पहले जो पीएसी कराना है तो उसमें हमें कैसे प्रॉब्लम आने वाली है
सही है सर
तो इसके लिए कुछ ना कुछ तो हमें अपनी एसोसिएशन के लेवल पे करना पड़ेगा
सही है सर
और दिल्ली के लेवल पे अगर कोई काम करना है किसी से मिलना है तो आप मेरे को गाइड करो सर मैं मिलता हूं उनसे
यस डेफिनेटली
सर गाइडलाइंस देखेंगे हम प्रॉपरली ड्राफ्ट बनाएंगे और हम प्रोसीड करेंगे सर।
ठीक सर, यही मैं चाहता हूँ कि आप एक बार गाइडलाइन को देख लीजिए कि आईसीएमआर ने क्या गाइडलाइन इश्यू की है मार्केट के अंदर कि इन्वेस्टिगेशन किसकी प्रिस्क्रिप्शन पे होना चाहिए। बेस्ड ऑन दैट हम अपना एक नीमा के लेटर पे एक अपना जो है ड्राफ्ट लेटर करें और देन उसको हम अपनी हायर अथॉरिटीज तक लेके चले।
नहीं, ये तो क्लियर हो गया है ऑलरेडी कि वो अपने को मेडिको नहीं समझते, यानी कि वो 1950 से उसको खाली मेडिको समझते हैं, तो क्लियर हो गया है पूरी तरह से।
वो तो उनके मन में से अभी गया ही नहीं है सर। वो नीति आयोग ने अभी जो टेलीमेडिसिन के जो गाइडलाइंस निकाले हैं,
हां जी सर,
उसमें भी आरएमपी के डेफिनेशन में वही लिखा है कि दोज हु आर रजिस्टर्ड विद इंडियन मेडिकल काउंसिल, सॉरी मेडिकल काउंसिल ऑफ इंडिया एमसीआई में जो रजिस्टर्ड है।
ठीक है सर, तो अगर ऐसा है तो
इम्प्लिसाइट
तो हमें अपने एक लेटर को ड्राफ्ट करना चाहिए और लेटर लेकर के चलना चाहिए अपनी हायर अथॉरिटीज को, मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ आयुष में भी रिप्रेजेंटेशन दे और आईसीएमआर में भी रिप्रेजेंटेशन दे।
बिल्कुल सर, बिल्कुल,
यस यस,
थैंक यू सर,
थैंक यू, थैंक्स अ लॉट,
थैंक्स नितिन सर, थैंक्स कटावकर सर, थैंक्स टू यू डॉक्टर धनंजय सर, थैंक यू।
नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन डॉक्टर धारवे सर,
व्हाट अबाउट कोविड नेगेटिव पेशेंट क्लोज रिलेटिव स्वैब टेस्ट? If someone positive from his close relative, then what to do before performing surgery? From Dr. Bhau Sahib Patange, Pusat.
If anybody from the contacts are positive, then screening, in the screening, the patient is deemed to be positive. So the testing is mandatory before surgery.
Another question from Nima Solapur. In this pandemic, we, the Ayush doctor, done brilliant work in which in his field. Is this data helpful in our upcoming cases, which are going on in different courts regarding integrated practice? In this pandemic,
definitely, yes. That was a big yes to it.
Another question from Bhau Sahib Patange. Quarantine is not advised. Our Ayush doctor during COVID duty, actually is advised in norms.
What about COVID negative patients? Which question, sir?
Quarantine is not advised to our Ayush doctor during COVID, basically after COVID duty, aisa hai, to usne during COVID duty likha.
Quarantine is not advised, our Ayush doctor during the COVID duty, actually advised in norm.
Sir, actually norms have been changed now, and the current norms are not allowing for quarantine facility for doctors.
Instead of 14 days, 7 days and be given to doctors. 7 days quarantine, sir. And after that they can join the duty.
Yes, yes, yes. And the government has said in the court that the doctor have their own on their own responsibility have to do work in their COVID wards.
Come on, next, take next.
Yesterday's judgment.
Yesterday's judgment only.
Yes.
Nirabhut, question is over from here. Similar question has to be asked.
Yeah, same questions.
Same question has to be asked.
So with this, we can move to our CC president.
Yes, sir. Please.
Yeah. So sir, I welcome question, yes, sir. Patan, sir.
Sir, please, sir. If the questions are over, I will lay some additional information. We will discuss as a legal team member. Sir, what are the remedies if one doctor is arrested under Section 188?
But sir, it is bailable offence, no, sir.
Bailable, but sahni apan kaise apan te he karu shakto? What are the remedies against it?
Remedy in what respect 188 has been imposed? We have to see, sir. If regarding the duty, if it is attracted, then Section 4 of the Epidemic Diseases Act will come in action. And
that is for all.
It is for all.
That is for all the doctors who have done his practice in a good faith.
Yes.
What if a doctor is arrested under Section 188? He is disobeying the order of the government and he has been arrested under 188. Then what can be done in this? If some doctor comes to us as a member of legal team, what we can do for that doctor?
We'll have to go through the merits of the case, sir. We'll have to go.
Yes, every what are the allegations in that?
Shall I put? कुछ मैं इसमें इंफॉर्मेशन
दूं? राजेश दशा पूछे, प्लीज डोंट शेयर योर स्क्रीन.
दहा पुते
सर, प्लीज डोंट शेयर योर स्क्रीन सर विदाउट परमिशन ऑफ अवर स्पीकर. यस सर, प्लीज.
द कोड ऑफ शैल आई ऐड समथिंग.
हां श्योर सर.
द कोड ऑफ क्रिमिनल प्रोसीजर कोड ऑफ 1973, इट लेज ऑन अ सेक्शन 195. Section 9, uh-huh. We can fight against 188 by using the section 195.
Okay.
But it says precaution for contempt of lawful authority of public servant for offenses against public justice and for offenses related to documents given in evidences. Okay. No court shall take cognizance of any offense punishable under section 172 to section 188. Both are inclusive of the Indian Penal Code of 1860.
Okay.
You can use the section 195 of CRPC to defend any court of law.
You want to say the remedy is under 188?
Yeah.
Read along with 172 of CRPC. Yes,
correct.
We will go through afterwards in detail.
And again, two sections I want to pay a highlight over this. We have discussed only the two sections. Section 188. Again, there are two sections. That's section 269. This is negligent act likely to spread infection or disease, dangerous to life.
Correct.
Also, section 270.
Yes.
Okay, malignant. Previously, I discussed with Khatavgarh sir also. This one, section 269 and section 270.
Even 271 comes in action, sir, because it is regarding the inspection of the vessels and quarantine facilities.
Yes, sir. Even Madras High Court has also given the decision on the one who was arrested under section 188. I don't know the case of that name.
Go through, Mujahid, go through 269 and 270 in short.
Yes, sir. See, section 269 says that negligent act likely to spread infection or disease dangerous to life. This is section 269. Nah. Whoever unlawfully or negligently does any act which is and which he knows or has reason to believe to be likely to spread the infection of any disease dangerous to life shall be punished with imprisonment of either description for a term which may extend to 6 months or with fine or both. This says section 269 and section 270. Malignant act likely to spread infection of disease dangerous to life. Whoever malignantly does any act which is and which he knows or has reason to believe to be likely to spread the infection of any disease dangerous to life shall be punished with imprisonment or either description for a term which may extend to 2 years or fine. These are public health and safety, I think. These are given under the public health and safety.
Yeah, malignant word comes as in respect of deliberate action.
Yeah. In respect of the malignant act 270 and this one. In view of the above, the medical profession must follow strictly the standard set for treating patients suffering from the dangerous disease such as AIDS, hepatitis and now the COVID. Such patient must be kept in isolation and handled with caution, such as wearing gloves, wearing the PPE, while handling separate new disposable syringes, and we should take the personal protective care. So these two section also added in addition to section 188 and in addition to section 188. Yeah. Sorry.
In our Solapur, one hospital has got effect of those two sections. Those two sections have been imposed on that hospital.
Oh, I see. Recently, I got one information.
But the problem is that the offenses are under this act are cognizable.
Okay.
But bailable. And non-compoundable. So, section 188 and 269, 270 cannot be read with one another. This is the problem.
Exactly.
Recently, one of my colleague friend who is working in Podar Hospital, M.A. Podar Hospital, Worli, which is again taken over by the corporation as a COVID hospital. And at the ground floor, the casualty and the other departments are working. And the patients who are admitted on first floor, they are spitting. And this fellow doctor came to me, what could be done? I was thinking, just now it clicked me, that section 270 can be of his use, that malignant act. Isn't it, Dr. Patan?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Patan?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So it can be of use. Anything else?
Questions?
Dr. Dahapute want to share one document related to today's topic.
Okay.
I think first show that document or discuss with our speaker.
First, what is the, in short, let him tell.
Open his mic.
He's our state office bearer and president of BYD.
Dr. Dahapute, please unmute yourself.
Very well known, Dr. Dahapute, sir.
Nima Bhiwandi, Doctor, President Nima Bhiwandi.
Yes, sir. Dr. Rajesh Dahapute, please, sir.
Sir,
welcome, Rajesh.
Thank you, sir. Sir, related to COVID test, एक document मेरे पास है जो आपको मैं share कर रहा था. तो अभी share करूँ sir?
हाँ, please, sir.
You want to show the referral form that I also have?
Sir, already sent to you.
Okay. You show it.
Yeah.
It was. Same it was shown.
There is no इतने पूछे यहाँ पे कहीं पे mention नहीं किया sir MBBS doctor ही covid test करते हैं. Hello.
हाँ sir.
ICMR they mentioned that नीचे देखिए I am aware that if I feel to follow है ना ICMR के बारे में लिखा है नीचे.
ICMR guideline.
Guidelines regarding COVID.
And clear at MCI registration करके लिखा है sir वहाँ. Including cancellation of MCI registration. They are considering only MCI registration.
I am aware that ICMR guidelines regarding COVID-19 and the testing protocol. I carefully above patient is symptomatic and is referred to the as per the ICMR guidelines. Clear cut लिखा है.
हाँ लिखा है. I am aware that if aware I fail to follow the ICMR guidelines, MCGM testing protocol, I am liable for action deemed fit by MCGM, including cancellation of MCI registration. They are only considering MCI registration.
This sentence was perhaps put in the. By this reason, perhaps some people give the advise the test without examining or following proper protocol. This is for them, and this and all the initial notices were for doctor registered under MCI. And then after few days, even if you see the dates of ICMR notices to allopaths and to ISM doctors, so it is clear cut. Initially, it came against doctors registered under MCI, and afterwards it came to doctor registered under MCIM.
Okay.
Next. Nitin sir, unmute करा तुम्हाला.
थोड़ा दौड़ काली उन पर है, तरह से दूर पर है ना. माइका ना दूर पर बसे.
Doctor Rajesh, would you want to add something or to continue with another question?
Actually, there is one more format. Just I am searching. I am not getting it now. One more format is also there.
Home tune out. Tell it to. Sold you today, that? No. Did you
get? Yeah, it's still going. Hey, Kunal's phone. Loud noise. Are you phone calling? Are you there?
Nitin sir.
Rajesh, listen. Mic mute. Kar 2 minutes. Rajesh.
Okay. Yes, sir.
हेलो हाय टॉपिक क्राय ऑफ द नेशन Even myself, even Dhadwe, we are in the Delhi group. We can see that people are crying. And what happens that instead of their personal
contribution to our personal efforts to solve the problem is zero. They want Shivaji to be born in neighbor's house. They want Shivaji to be born in neighbor's house. We will sit idle. This is very disgusting mentality, you know. I think one Dr. Ambalal Patil, he is from Alandi, is having very good influence in a particular political world. I think he has left. He
had, Nitin, he sir, please unmute yourself. Nitin, sir.
Nitin, sir, right now. Nitin, sir, bola.
Mute aaye the.
Nahi, zala, unmute zala.
Yeah, unmute zala.
So, should we proceed?
Hello, Roj, baste kar evada vel.
Hello, Dhananjay sir, should we proceed?
Haan, sir.
Question our ends.
There is a question, sir. Many of our colleagues have small OPDs.
OPDs.
Is it possible that government will take action considering this pandemic condition and crowd in our OPD? What can be done? See, there are two layers of this question. And whenever there is any order promulgated under section 144 regarding collection of the people. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Mute. Mute karke rakhiye.
Introduction pathun deu aami. Asa Nitin sir, 2 minutes.
Chavala bol gaye mandle he ay kalle.
Ha, mere mere piche kisi ne acha bola, mujhe bahut acha laga. So there are two layers to the question. One is whenever any order has been promulgated under section 144, any prohibitory order, then the responsibility to follow the order is on that person. Or वो आस्थापना जिसपे वो ये वो जो सबको लागू है, सभी दुकानों को, सभी दवाखानों को, जहाँ का भी लोग एकत्रित होने का है, वो सब आस्थापनाओं का ही वो जिम्मेदारी है कि वहाँ ज्यादा लोगों को एक साथ एकत्रित नहीं होने देना. So the onus is on our head or on our shoulders. So we'll have to take care of it. If your OPD is smaller, there is our personal problem. If government is going to take action, we cannot refuse it.
Social distancing has to be.
Social distancing is must under 144.
Asthapana is establishments, clinical establishments.
I think Katavkar sir, social distancing is not a proper word.
Physical distancing.
Physical distancing.
You should not use the word social distancing.
Yes, yes. Let us use now. From today onwards, everybody, physical distancing, and not 1 meter. Let us say 2 meters.
So with this last question, we will move toward our concluding this program. We have our CC president, Dr. Tembulnikar sir. I welcome you, sir. You have joined earlier, but all the session already the session had on, so I have not taken a chance to welcome you. So I welcome you in this NEMA webinar. I request you to please put your few words in this pandemic, Dr. Tembulnikar.
Thank you, Dr. Daga. Actually, no need to welcome me because अपने घर में आते हो कोई welcome नहीं करते अपने घर में घुसते वक्त तो. This is NEMA webinar and I am a family member of NEMA. At present, I am head of this, but I am just a member.
Family head of NEMA.
But I am just a member. So basically, I am not that fortunate कि मैं पहले इससे ये नहीं सुन सका. But all the hundreds of doctors who participated in, who had listened the lecture are very much fortunate to have such a beautiful lecture given by Dr. Dhananjay. And मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि उसके साथ हमारे जो भी लीगल के लोग हैं, कटावकर सर है, नितिन जी है, पठान सर है, इन्होंने सब ने मिल के ये अच्छा लेक्चर दिया है. And people are fortunate to have such a lecture in this crucial time. Basically, I want to congratulate all of you. और दूसरी बात ऐसी है कि दाढ़वे सर, डागा जी, आलोक जी, इन्होंने जो सीरीज रखी है उसके लिए भी मैं उनका शुक्रगुजार हूँ, क्योंकि सब ये पैंडेमिक में सब स्टैंड स्टिल हो गया था, लेकिन नीमा काम कर रही थी।
Yes, sir.
नीमा प्रोक्टोलॉजी सोसाइटी के माध्यम से वेबिनार शुरू थे और अभी 24-25 लेक्चर्स हो गए हैं और उसका रिस्पांस भी बहुत अच्छा है। सो एंड अबाउट द लेक्चर ऑफ धनंजय, हिज नॉलेज, हिज फ्लुएंसी, हिज कमांड ओवर द सब्जेक्ट इज एडोरेबल। बेसिकली अभी कोथळे जी ने भी अननोइंगली बोला है लड़का अच्छा है।
Knowingly, sir, knowingly बोला है, knowingly बोला।
नहीं नहीं, लेकिन उनको मालूम नहीं था ना, वो सब लोग सुन रहे तो एक्चुअली दिस इज धनंजय इज अ जेम दैट वी हैव, मिला है हमको एक हीरा मिला है और
yes.
हम लोग उसका एसोसिएशन के लिए और फॉर सबके जो प्रॉब्लम्स है वो सॉल्व करने के लिए जो हमारा लीगल सेल दिन रात काम कर रहा है उनमें हम लोग धनंजय को भी हमने उसमें जोड़ दिया है और ही इज डूइंग हिज बेस्ट। एंड हमारा लीगल सेल जो काम कर रहा है उसमें धनंजय भी आजकल बहुत इससे जिम्मेदारी से काम कर रहा है। बेसिकली आज जो सब्जेक्ट लिया था उसकी बहुत ही जरूरत थी, सब लोगों के मन में बहुत से क्वेश्चंस थे और बहुत से लोगों ने मुझे प्राइवेटली मैसेज करके धनंजय जी के नंबर मांगे है, तो मुझे लगता है कि चैट बॉक्स में उनका नंबर डिस्प्ले कर दीजिए।
यस यस
या, और मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि हमारे जो भी लीगल सेल है, लीगल सेल के जो भी लोग है सबके नंबर्स चैट बॉक्स में रोज डिस्प्ले करते जाइए, बिकॉज दिस इज नीड ऑफ आवर एंड वी पीपल आर सर्विंग द एसएम डॉक्टर्स ऑफ द नेशन डे एंड नाइट, जिनको सबको आज जरूरत है हमारी, हमारे लीगल जो नॉलेज है उसकी। तो यू शुड शेयर द नंबर्स ऑफ आवर लीगल सेल मेंबर्स डेली इन द चैट बॉक्स।
Good suggestion.
Yeah, and I with this I conclude. और फिर एक बार congratulations, thanks to Dhananjay, thanks to Gajanan, Girish and Alok, and above all I as usual I thank our legal members, legal team, Kothale ji, Mujahid और Khatavkar sir. Thank you.
मैं एक दो शब्द कहना चाहूँगा.
Yeah, Dhananjay, please. हाँ.
सर को थोड़ी आदत है अच्छा बोलने की किसी के बारे में, लेकिन इतना अच्छा ना बोला करे कि वो उसके बोझ तले वो दब जाए।
बोझ निकालने के लिए हम लोग सोलापुर आ जाते
हैं। जिम्मेदारी का बोझ इतना है।
हाँ सर, जिम्मेदारी तो
पहले से है
सर, जिम्मेदारी लेने से तो ताकत बढ़ती है सर, जिम्मेदारी
बढ़िया, इसीलिए तो उसी बोझ के तले हम दबाते हैं आपको।
मुरलीकर सर,
क्या? यस सर,
मुरलीकर सर।
हाँ सर बोलिए।
मुरलीकर सर बहुत बार सच बोलते हैं, आज भी उन्होंने सच बोला है।
नहीं, मैं हमेशा सच बोलता हूँ।
आपके आपके छत्र छाया तले तो पल रहा हूँ सर।
एनीवे थैंक यू एवरीबॉडी,
थैंक यू सर, थैंक यू, ओके बाय।
Thank you all. Thank you, Temburnikar sir. And I thanks to today's speaker, Dr. Dhananjay sir. I request Dr. Gajanan Dadve to give a formal vote of thanks. Dr. Gajanan Dadve sir.
Today's session is a very nice, informative session. Especially
thank you.
Our Nima Legal Committee. Thanks a lot for sharing valuable information with you. Special thanks. Dr. Dhananjay Kulkarni sir, our today's panelist Dr. Nitin Kothare sir, Dr. Khatavkar sir, and Dr. Mujahid Pathan sir, and our participants in today's webinar. Thank you.
Thank you sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you Dhananjay sir. And thank today's you. This webinar's recording we have available. We will make it on YouTube tomorrow. Because due to some technical reason, live YouTube was not there. And tomorrow it will be on our YouTube channel.
Sure.
Yes.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.
Bye.
Thank you. Khatavkar sir, end karu, conclude karu.
Yes.
Pathan sir.
Haan.
Yeah.
Nitin sir. Pan
hoi, yes, sir. Haan.
Nitin sir.
Mujahid sir.
Sangitle teni.
Yes, yes.
Nahi, nahi. Tyancha tayar kele ka pudcha.
धाडवे सरांना ती जास्त काळजी असते
आम्ही। मुजाहिद सर
एनजीडीटी ब्रेक नाही झाली पाहिजे।
उद्याच्या लंच मध्ये उद्याच्या हायटी मध्ये काय द्यायचं आहे. चलो थँक्यू एव्हरीबडी.
यस सर.
यस थँक्यू. आलोक सर.
यस 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 यू कॅन.
ओके थँक्यू.
यस ओके.